Call to order the regular meeting of the Elbert Lee City Council for Monday night, October 28th, 2024. Clerk, please call the roll.
Counselor Christensen.
Here.
Counselor Baker.
Here.
Counselor Howland.
Here.
Counselor Olson.
Here.
Counselor Rasmussen.
Here.
Counselor Anderson.
Here.
Mayor Murray.
Here. Would you please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome, everyone, tonight, whether you're here in person or online. Our next item of business will be ceremonial items, and tonight we are recognizing Elbert Lee Fire Captain Trevor Durod as the Fire Prevention Officer of the Year. Officer Durod, do you want to come on up? Let's get you up here in the center. Yeah. Thank you. So the Minnesota State Fire Chiefs Association recently named Elbert Lee Fire Captain Trevor Durod as Fire Prevention Officer of the Year. Over his 22 years with Elbert Lee Fire Rescue, Captain Durod has met with many groups to raise awareness about fire code enforcement, fire safety practices at businesses, and residential fire safety. He introduced training for firefighters on how to interact with special needs students without causing fear or anxiety. He also launched a living skills program to help students prepare for the real world with training on fire safety, first aid, and emergency preparedness. When accepting the award, Captain Durod said, "I'd like to thank my crew and all the members of the Elbert Lee Fire Rescue, because without their drive and vision, none of this would be possible. Congratulations, Trevor, and thank you for your devotion to the fire safety in Elbert Lee. We appreciate your service." We'll ask Officer J.D. Carlson now to say a couple of words.
Well, I tell you what, I've gone to the fire conference with Trevor and Deputy Chief Laskowski the last 3 years to try and be a better director and understand the fire industry more than what little I knew originally a few years back. And this year I didn't go, and look what happens. He receives an award. But congratulations to Trevor. We're very proud of him. This is a huge award for Elbert Lee and Trevor himself. It's a state award. He was actually recognized up with his peers at the State Fire Conference, which is awesome. We're just really proud. And one thing I've said recently, too, I mean, we've got the opportunity, being police and firefighters, to do, it's a kid's dream to be in these positions and to have fun doing it, and he gets to follow through with, obviously, what's a passion in his life. So I think that's pretty awesome. But congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, Trevor. Yep.
Congratulations.
And he's got a squad out here with him tonight, too, so thank you guys for attending, and everyone be safe out there. Thank you.
Awesome.
All right. J.D., do we have anybody on public forum? All right.
It's just my chicken scratch.
Oh, okay.
This is Jerry Collins.
Yeah, you can hardly read it.
Well, I was in a hurry because we were doing the pledge.
Oh, okay. All right, come on up, Mr. Collins. State your name and your business.
Jerry Collins, one of the owners of Big Dream Organics, one of the cannabis businesses here in town. Actually, I think the only one that's cannabis-specific in town right now. So I know we're going to have a second and I assume third reading yet tonight for the proposed ordinance. And so I guess just generally speaking, I thought it looked pretty darn good overall. I do think there are some things that are we're a little too conservative on. One of the things, so having spoke with Mr. Rigg, I know that we're going to try and bring some of the other adult-themed businesses that we've termed it in Elbert Lee into some parity with what this new cannabis statute will be, or city code will be. And so one of the things that concerned me was the currently, of course, there's only allowance for 2 licenses, which would be the absolute minimum that the state would require the city to allow. And I would not necessarily pigeonhole that. And I know that it another business could come in and then request an additional license be issued by the city. But it, you know, we've got 10, 12 liquor licenses that are liquor stores, what, nine liquor stores amongst the other on and off sale licenses in town. And we've never seen an issue with that. And so, you know, speaking of parity, you know, there's all kinds of things like the public consumption. While we issue permits all the time for block parties, for drinks uptown on wind down Wednesdays, if they don't get rained out, of course, that seems to happen a lot. And so I guess if we're going to look at parity, I would say that, you know, we have a lot of existing city ordinances that are much more liberal than what the cannabis ordinance is. And I would hope that maybe the council and the mayor and legal counsel would maybe hold off just a second and take a look back at that. And, you know, if we're going to bring things in parity, let's present what that parity is going to be between liquor licenses, tobacco licenses, and sexually oriented businesses. You know, I heard a lot in the first reading about the parity, but I didn't really see a lot of it in the ordinance as is written. So I wouldn't get too locked down tight on it, because this is especially early going in the cannabis space. As we move forward with legalization, it is an absolute monster money generator for municipalities that have these stores in there. And if you're too locked down and make it not friendly to cannabis individuals, we run the risk of essentially never having that additional tax revenue. So that's what I have. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, we'll move along to item 5, consent and approval of agenda. Item A is approval of the minutes of the October 14th, 2024 regular council meeting. Item B is the approval of minutes of the October 14th, 2024 work session. Item C is license and permits. Item D is a resolution approving gambling permit for the Twin Lakes Firemen's Relief Association. Council?
Move to approve the consent and approval of the agenda, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second, Your
Honor. Second by Councilor Anderson. Any questions or discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item 6 is petitions, requests, and communications, and we have none tonight. Item 7 is unfinished business. Under item A, ordinance 24-128, amending chapter 12, article 11, taxicab, section 12.373, insurance, second reading. City manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. Seems to be a difference here between the agenda and another item where it says it's 10 or 11, but it's the taxi cab section. This amendment reflects those changes in the language related to the required amounts of public liability and bodily injury insurance by clarifying the necessary amounts without being too excessive. This is the final reading of this ordinance. Approval is recommended.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Anderson. Is there a second? Excuse me, Councilor Baker. Are you giving me the second?
I'll give you a second.
Thank you, Councilor Anderson. I was ahead of myself, sorry.
Yeah, I see that.
Any questions or discussion?
Your Honor.
Councilor Howland.
Just to make sure that we're voting on the correct chapter and article, do we know, is it 10 or 11?
City manager?
I want to say it's 10, but I don't have the actual ordinance in the chapter code book right in front of me, but it is the article that is for taxi cabs, and it's only for taxi cabs.
Okay, so we're all right if we say that it's 11 and it turns out it is 10.
If we're voting, I think if we just say the section related to taxi cabs, we're good.
It is 11. Okay.
Okay.
Hearing that from staff.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is the last agenda. If you wanted to see the number.
Yeah, it was 11. Then it's an error in the WBI. Okay.
All right, so we'll change that to 11.
Yes.
Any additional discussion?
No, it was chapter 12, article 11. Article 11. Okay. So you said it correctly. I said it wrong.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. All right. Hearing no further discussion, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item B is ordinance 24-129, chapter 5, cannabis business. second reading. City Manager?
Other than just a few moments ago, this city staff and the city manager has not received any other comments from business owners or the public on the adoption of the ordinance. This ordinance is focusing on licensing of cannabis sales, events, and commercial allowances of low-potency items within our local authority. Approval is recommended by staff. I would just also like to clarify, due to some of the comments that were made, that this is not the second reading and there is not a third reading. This is the final reading. And that we are, when it came to the issue of parity, we're actually looking at creating more restrictions on those particular businesses. So while they are not as restrictive as what this is now, we are looking at applying some of those restrictions. And then also in our workshop discussion, we did also mention the fact that the state is also going to create a certain level of, I would say, sort of forced placement. They're also going to be looking at trying to distribute, at least that's the intent. They don't want it all concentrated in Minneapolis. They want it spread out throughout the state so that way geographically people have access to it. Because the idea is for them to try to get rid of the illicit trade. And that the state minimum requirement that, or the state minimum that we can restrict it to is 2, and currently the ordinance does have 2 set as the max. But if at any point the council ever decided to change that amount, it would have to go through a first and second reading of an ordinance adoption, which would probably take a total of anywhere from, I would say, from the start 3 to 6 weeks, dependent upon when council meetings fell and when the need presented itself and staff were able to get the item changed. But it's very, very specific in this ordinance that is going to make it so that way only a very small section of it has to change. There's not any other places throughout the ordinance, either in this chapter or any other chapters, that would require that change. So if the council ever did decide to expand the number, it would be only in, it's gonna be one of these sections here. But it's just only one particular section, so. That's it.
Council.
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Christensen. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Howland. Any further discussion? Councilor Christensen.
I just want to say for the public that this has been a long process by the city and its staff and the council, looking at the issue, meeting with groups, looking to the guidance that's provided by the state and its regulations. And I feel that we have, yes, taken a conservative approach that doesn't prevent us from moving forward in the future, if that's warranted. But I do think that we've listened to the public that has spoken out, and I think we've followed their guidance.
Thank you. Councilor Baker.
Yeah, I'm gonna ask the same question I asked in the work session, is if somebody came to the city and wanted to open up a cannabis business, and we, according to our ordinance, we only allow 2, they can then ask the city to look back at that and see if they can't open up for another one, correct?
City Manager?
Basically, they would ask the city, can you change the ordinance limiting it? And it would be only one line that would be replaced from 2 to 3 or just scratched altogether, which is under 2.6. So I believe section 2.6 under chapter 5, item C is the only thing that would have to be changed. So there's one sentence that says the city of Albert Lea shall limit the number of cannabis retail businesses to 2. And that could be edited to 3, or you could just simply say the city of Albert Lea shall not limit the number of cannabis retail businesses. However the council decides to at a later date amend this, they can certainly do that, and it would take a very short period of time.
Okay, so, and maybe I misunderstood, then we went a little farther on that. as to, we talked about the state, would the state, if we amended it to allow three businesses within the city limits, and they figured out the paperwork, sent it all in, is the state going to allow a third one in the city limits? Or I was under the understanding that they're looking to spread it out would be in the county. Did I understand that right?
City manager?
My understanding is that the state would like to see a certain number distributed based on population and geography throughout the state to remove the illicit sale and have them licensed retail and sale and cultivation. How exactly that's going to play out 100% with the state, I cannot be absolutely certain and speak to that. Part of this is going to play out. What I can tell you, though, is on our end, when it comes to the restrictions, if the council ever decided to remove the restrictions, let's say we get first and second license approved, things are going well, there's been some interest, but people really haven't gone through the process, and the council decides, you know what, maybe we might want to open it up some more. They certainly have that, they certainly would have that option to also make that change in advance and don't necessarily have to wait for an applicant to come forward. So, but if an applicant comes forward, I don't know exactly what that will look like in this, under the current one, if there is a third.
So basically, we could approve that, but we would be leaving it up to the state would make the final decision as if we could put one within the city limits or if it would have to be spread out somewhere else in Freeborn County, or is that, we don't know that, correct?
Wouldn't outside Freeborn County be up to the county?
Well, Freeborn County can't restrict it to any less than three. And right. Every community inside Freeborn County has to allow it at least one.
So every city, little city in?
I want to say yes, but there may be an exclusion for really small communities, like maybe 500, but
I guess I'm confused because I thought it was 12,500 per.
It doesn't mean that they're actually going to get approved, though.
Okay.
So well, county,
my question is.
You could have one here, we could have one in Glendale, we could have one in, let's say, Hayward.
Okay.
But, and that would be the county's three, and I don't know if we'd be able to do another one or not.
And I get that. I understand that. It's going to be up to the state, but I'm glad that we're putting this, you know, I would support opening it up for other ones when the time comes. It just kind of makes it really unclear what, I mean, they didn't spell it out very well, actually, if you really think about it, to answer some of the questions that are out there.
I think our gap in knowledge is going to be how this is administered at the state level and how the communication goes and flows.
Okay.
That's going to be a big step in all of this, just the same as with alcohol and all of that. Once it gets established, gets moving, we're going to have a much clearer vision of this. And as I stated, I believe, last council meeting, we're probably going to be coming back at this in 6 to 12 months anyway, once we start to get that clarity from the state. It's just right now, as a matter of input that we've received from the public and everything that I've heard from the elected officials, we're kind of starting off at the more conservative end, and then as things progress, make those determinations. But there are a lot of unknown. We know there are many unknowns, mm-hmm. and we're just going to have to adapt to those over time as it comes in.
So just another question. With what it says in this, where it says something about they're going to do two, but we will allow or give the opportunity that the council can overturn this and make it more, maybe one more, two more, whatever the need be. Does that say so in that?
Now, it doesn't say so in there, but it's a matter of practicality that it's just an ordinance change, and it will not be as extensive as the creation. It will be a minor adjustment to just one line within the whole entire ordinance. Okay. And so it really does make it very simple that if the council does wish to expand upon it, it's one sentence that has to get changed.
Okay, well, I just so it's written in a way that future councils, when they read it, they understand the fact that they have the opportunity to overturn it and expand if everything works out that way, is what I would be concerned with.
I believe that's the way it reads, but other people could read it differently. But I know the intent was to make it very easy for if the council politically decided, you know, after, you know, constituents and all that, all kind of give feedback and everyone feels good about it, that if they wish to change it, they would be able to do so, and it would be a very simple process for the council, because that was a debate. Should it be two? Should it be four? Should it be whatever the state says it should be geographically? Because we also know the state, again, is going to want to create some restrictions anyway, just naturally on their approval, because they do want it distributed throughout the state. So they don't want Albert Lea to be the cannabis mecca and then not have anything until you hit Minneapolis, as an example. Not that that would happen, but they would see that as a failure on their end if that's how the distribution went.
Councilor Anderson.
I'm going to be supporting this mostly because I view it as this is going to be the framework of what will eventually be our cannabis ordinance when the state actually gets around to rolling it all out. So I think it's important to establish a framework so we can make those tweaks down the road as the situations arise that we don't even know what they'll be yet. Your Honor.
Thank you. Any other discussion?
Your Honor.
Councilor Howland.
Yeah, I'll agree with Councilor Anderson. That's kind of how I see it too. You know, this is sort of our baseline, and as we move forward, and there's going to be a lot more clarity, but this kind of gets us started, and we'll see how it goes. But I think this is a good start and a good base.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Christensen.
Aye.
Councilor Baker.
Aye.
Councilor Howland.
Aye.
Councilor Olson.
Aye.
Councilor Rasmussen.
Aye.
Councilor Anderson.
Aye.
Mayor Murray.
Aye. Motion carries. Item C is resolution permitting publication summary of ordinance 24-129 cannabis. City Manager.
Thank you, Your Honor. Summaries fulfill a legal requirement as if the entire summarized matter had been published, and also directs the public how to obtain a complete copy of the ordinance. Staff recommends approval to publish ordinance summary of ordinance 24-129 cannabis.
Council.
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Anderson. Is there a second?
Second, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Howland. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item 8, new business. Item A is a resolution approving the main corridor grant for 1206 West Front Street. City Manager.
Thank you, Your Honor. The Main Corridor Renewal Grant is intended to assist property owners with making facade and site improvements that preserve the architectural character of the property, improve the curb appeal, and or spur economic development along the city's main commercial corridors. ALCPAS LLC, TM Thompson Properties LLC, and BNS Bland Properties LLC applied for a matching grant for facade restoration under Main Corridor Renewal Grant policy for site assessment, removal of existing parking lot, grading and drainage improvements, and constructing a new parking lot. Total project cost is $46,521, which will provide the property owners with a matching grant of up to $23,260.50. The project has been reviewed and approved by the city's zoning and building official as required per policy, and approval is recommended by staff.
Council?
So moved.
Motion by Councilor Howland. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Baker. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item 9 is the mayor and council reports, and we'll start with Councilor Howland, Ward 3.
Thank you, Your Honor. No ward items. I'm hoping that city manager can address something here for the public that I had asked him about, and maybe the other councilors received this in the mail. A letter from HomeServe, which I received, and I got some questions from other residents in my ward about it, asking for our residents to sign up for HomeServe when the home serve program, for the most part, most city residents are already signed up for this program. This is for sewer and water pipe protection on your home. If you need repairs, you're automatically enrolled in that if you get a city bill. So just hoping the city manager can clarify that home serve isn't trying to double dip here, or Freeborn Mower Electric was also added on in the letter and said that they were partnering with home serve. So I want to make sure that, you know, some of our residents weren't duped by home serve in getting this letter, and how many of these letters went out.
City manager, would you like to address that now?
I certainly can. Okay. There was a mistake made in which residents inside the city boundaries of the city of Albert Lea, who have water and sewer connection, were sent a letter because they're also customers of Freeborn Mower Electric Cooperative, and that wasn't the intent. It was meant to be the individuals that are on sewer and septic were to receive this opportunity to sign up. So it was just an error in which the letter went out to more people than it intended, and that home serve had no intention of swapping people out from the city's plan over to Freeborn Mower that are already on the city's plan or inside the city limits.
So what happens and what is happening? I'm assuming there's probably some residents that aren't aware that they get this coverage already in the city limits and are, you know, checking the yes box on the letter. And is home serve, I want to just make sure that they're not double dipping and getting twice the amount of money from our residents.
I do believe that they are not, even if someone sent everything in, they're not going to do it if they're already on the city's program or inside the city's boundaries and able to do the current service that we do have signed up. Like I said, it went out in error. They know that it's an error, and so they are not going to switch anyone over to a different plan than what the city already has. That is my understanding, and I know that our staff has, at least shortly after the letters first went out, had spent quite a bit of time talking to people, calling up and asking these questions. I know we also had to put some information out there as well, and I think people have understood and received that well, but home serve also is aware, and they are not going to switch anyone over, or should not be switching anyone over.
Or double charging.
And if someone has a question, then bring it forward. If you're already on the city's plan and you think you might be charged, we'd be more than happy to try to work with them on it and contact Home Serve and make sure it's correct. Or Freeborn Mower will. They're also aware of the situation too.
So a message to residents out there, if you got this letter and signed up for this Home Serve service, and you're not sure if you're getting double charged or whatever, they should call the city?
They could call us, they could call Freeborn Mower, they could call Home Serve directly. Home Serve might be the best source to start off with.
Okay, thank you. That's it, Your Honor.
Thank you. Ward 2, Councilor Baker.
Thank you, Your Honor. I don't have any ward items, so to speak. I did have last week we had a LEDA meeting, and just went over some of the things that are going on. I did get a notice in the mail that we're going to have a special meeting coming up. I think it's on the 12th, and to talk about a potential business that might be here. And so it sounds like that's pretty promising. So we'll probably know more about this in the next 3 weeks or so. And then obviously we went over some other things and basic, you know, in-house checking all the dots and crossing the T's and checking all, you know, the bills and stuff that went out. But I thought that was pretty exciting news. And there again, I'm just going to repeat myself. There are a lot of things happening within the city of Albert Lea with a lot of the entities within the city that are moving together and making this possible. I'm sure the mayor will probably expound on that a little bit when he when it comes to his turn. I also had, last Tuesday, we had a meeting, an HRA meeting. Alita Director Philip Johnson was there along with the city manager, and they were just talking about the housing issue. That was seemed to be one of the big things that is an issue in this community. We don't have enough housing, and there's a lot of members, a lot of entities in this community that are starting to work together to make sure we can cover the housing issue and get some more housing in this community so we can house the people that will be coming to or are working at some of our newer businesses and hopefully newer businesses coming in and maybe expansions of some of our other businesses within the community. They're going to need housing, so that was basically what they were talking about, and we've been talking about that on the board too, as far as the housing. And now I'm pretty sure that's going to be first and foremost. Some of the conversations that we're going to have is housing and what we can do to help do our part, team up with whether it be the city, Alita, the county, or everybody in different situations. That's going to, well, you know, we're going to start moving forward. It's not going to happen overnight. It's going to take a while. But as far as I can see, everybody's on board and moving in the right direction. So I think that's a plus for this community. That'll be it, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. Ward 1, Councilor Christensen.
Thank you, Your Honor. First of all, I want to say at our last meeting, I misspoke. I said that at November 12th, we will be reviewing assessments, but not at our council meeting. November 11th is Veterans Day, and so council will meet on Tuesday instead of Monday. So hearing on final assessments for Greenwood Drive or any other projects is going to be on the 12th, not Monday the 11th, on the 12th. Currently, I'm serving on three different commissions and groups. Budget Committee continues to operate. Planning and zoning work was reflected, I think, very well tonight as we approved the cannabis ordinance. Blue Zone is working on many different levels, including the Worksite Wellness Group is very active, continues to build support for healthy workplaces within our community. And then just in case you can still get in next Sunday, there is a plant-based cooking class at the Seventh-day Adventist class. It does require registration, but if you can get into it, it was excellent. I went a month ago, and it was just very well done. The Seventh-day Adventist group located in Loma Linda is one of the only natural Blue Zone committee communities in the United States. It is the only natural. We are a certified Blue Zone community. Loma Linda, largely because of the Seventh-day Adventists and their guidelines for healthy living, is what makes them a community where people tend to live healthy for much longer lives. And so anyway, they do a beautiful job on that program. I also wanted to just add a word about politics. And I want to thank the Albert Lea Tribune for sharing in-depth interviews with our local candidates. One of my joys in serving as a city councilor is that I'm not in a partisan position. And truly, we all work together here for the best of our community, and that is a wonderful thing. One of the commonalities that I found as I was reading the different interviews is so many of us talk about what's our biggest skill that we bring to this position, and it is listening. Trying to hear from the public, what the public is really interested in. And here's where it comes to you, the public. If you don't reach out to us and engage with us, then we can't do the best job that we can do. So please read, listen, discuss, and reach out to your elected officials. And in that way, our decisions can be informed by you. And then, of course, go vote on November 5th. Finally, I want to give a shout out to area musicians. Today in Austin, the Austin Symphony played a concert, well, two actually, for almost 3,000 area youth. Children that will be of the age, will be starting to play either in band or orchestra. There's a number of Albert Lee musicians that either play with the orchestra, and lots of our local youth were in attendance at that program. And it's just, you know, being a part of a music group is something that you can do your whole life long, and I can attest to that because after, oh, more years than I want to say, I'm still active doing it, and it's wonderful to be a part of. And I thank you. That's it.
All right. Thank you. Councilor Anderson.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Ward 6.
Ward 6. I got two ward items working on. The reason I say that, the reason all of us say that, I'm sure, is because if it's you and you're listening to this, you know that we're at least we're starting on it. Because, as Councilor Christensen said, that's one of the most important parts of our job. We want to make sure that we are listening to the people, and we love getting feedback. Larry, Councilor Baker, had some comments about the HRA meeting. That's great. It was a great meeting. It's exciting seeing the things that the HRA can do. Since I've been on the board, HRA has seemed to be kind of in a damage control mode because there's been, you know, new people coming and going. But, you know, we haven't exactly turned that corner yet, but I see the corner up in the distance. It's on the horizon. And when we do, there's some really neat things that they'll be able to do for housing. So I kind of look forward to being a part of that board as we make that transition into moving forward. Also had a budget meeting. I'm still, you know, drowning in the shallow water on budget stuff because it's my first year on the that committee. But yeah, it's very illuminating. And I early voted. I invite other people to do the same. I was up to the courthouse to pay my property tax, and I seen all the polling things there, and it was really easy. If you want to get that responsibility out of your way, it's pretty simple. If you can think of any other reason to go up there, you can maybe get your tabs and vote at the same time and save yourself the trouble on election day. Either way, we got another week and a half or so, and then it'll be over, Your Honor.
8 days. Councilor Rasmussen,
yeah, Your Honor,
Ward 5.
I don't have any ward items, and I have a library board meeting in a couple weeks.
All right. Ward 4, Councilor Olson.
Yep, just like to thank the police department for taking care of a couple issues that I had emailed them last week. It was very much appreciated, and that's really about it. And I'll be voting at the regular time, so if anyone wants to talk to me, see you at Grace Lutheran Church. That's it, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. My report for tonight, we did have a lead update meeting, and Councilor Baker is correct that we will be meeting with a prospective employer here in the next couple weeks to try to finalize a land deal. So hopefully that'll be coming together, and it could be a very, very nice project for our community. I also spent some time this past week with the Realtors Association. I believe it was the Southeastern Minnesota Realtors. And there was about 40 people there that were either real estate professionals or worked with home mortgages, financing, things of that nature. And so had a good discussion with them about what's going on in the city of Albert Lea. And of course, they're very interested in the same thing many of us are interested in, housing, and what's going on in the housing. So we talked about a number of different projects there that we are working on going forward, and I think they were quite excited about the things that were happening. And then also spent some time on another project with Alita, working on a recharge event and just some additional opportunities in that arena. So that is what I was doing this past week. And then calendar of events coming up here. I'd just like to mention tonight in Albert Lea at the high school, we have a National Honor Society induction ceremony. So a bunch of young people getting into the National Honor Society. So what an honor for them. Congratulations on achieving that. And then a few other things going on in the community. This Wednesday, October 29th, from 3:30 to 5:30, is the last farmer's market of the season. So get out to North Broadway and get the last of your homegrown vegetables, fruit, homemade baked goods, jams, and more. October 31st, Halloween event, second annual Halloween party for you and your pets at the Pet Authority at 2014 East Main. Event is 3 to 5 p.m. Halloween event at the Law Enforcement Center. JD, are you dressing up? And no, not sure. Okay. 411 Broadway Avenue South. Tours of emergency vehicles, meet the staff, trick or treat, and the event is from 4 to 6 p.m. The Halloween Spooktacular in downtown Albert Lea. Trick or Treat at participating downtown stores. Event is from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. And I might just add, I drove by the fairgrounds here a couple times this weekend, and it was one hopping place. So the Oktoberween or whatever they were, what was going on out there was pretty darn busy. So it looked like a lot of people were taking part. So that's pretty nice. And then don't forget, Sunday, November 3rd at 2 a.m. is daylight savings time. It's time to fall back. Don't forget to set your clocks back 1 hour and get an extra hour of sleep. Tuesday, November 5th is a general election. Polls in the city of Albert Lea open at 7 a.m. and close at 8 p.m. Please take the opportunity to get out and vote for national, state, and local races. Polling locations are as follows. Ward 1, Fair Lane Building at the Freeborn County Fairgrounds. Ward 2, First Lutheran Church, 301 West Clark. Ward 3, United Methodist Church, 702 South Highway 69. Ward 4, Grace Lutheran Church, 918 Garfield Avenue. Ward 5 is at the National Guard Armory. Ward 6 is at the Assembly of God Church at 1540 South Shore Drive. So get out and vote. And some other options for voting. As a couple of the counselors mentioned, you can vote in person this week, November 2nd and 3rd, from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the Freeborn County Government Center. And then the Auditor Treasurer Office in the Freeborn County Government Center will also be open for voting until 7 p.m. tomorrow, October 29th, and until 5 p.m. on Monday, November 4th. And if you don't make it to those, get out on November 5th and cast your vote. And that's all I have for tonight. So we'll move on to the City Manager Report.
Thank you, Your Honor. We're waiting on open enrollment to end for us to finalize budget recommendations, both to the Budget Committee and then to the Council. We're preparing for the Council retreat on the 13th of November. I would like to thank the City Clerk and especially our Deputy Clerk here, Carla, on their hard work for the elections. These elections take place, but it takes a lot of people, and that takes a couple special people to get all those election workers and judges lined up and scheduled, and it's not an easy task. Just also with some of the regulations that have gone through, just the training that they've also had to update has been keeping them pretty busy. So I just want to thank them for their hard work on that. We continue to meet with developers on housing. I have asked for some updates on some of the TIF performances from our financial advisors. We're waiting. We have already noticed, and now we are waiting some bids and some documents for related to Blazing Star for the cleanup for the development there on the corner lot. With daylight savings times come up, I believe that is supposed to be the normal time which you change your batteries out on your smoke detectors. So please check those, change those out, make sure you stay safe. And then I want to talk about a very important subject, and that is Halloween. So Halloween started off with some old pagan beliefs that say the veil between the earthly world and the mystical world is thinnest on those middle points between equinoxes and solstices. And so between the fall equinox and the winter solstice, the land of the dead and the land of the living is less separated. And so that's why you must dress up as scary monsters and do your jack-o'-lanterns and all that to keep the spirits away. So eventually, in the British Isles, Western churches decided to assign All Hallows Day to November 1st, which created All Hallows Eve on October 31st, as we now just shorthand call it Halloween. And by the Middle Ages, children would go around doing something that was called souling. And that is where they would go and they would offer prayers to households and families for the souls of dearly departed ones. And they would get a like raisin cookie or a sweet cookie in return. So this was the very start of trick-or-treating. And in the United States, as Irish-Scottish immigrants came here mid-century, Halloween took on more of a prank nature to it for about the first century. But due to the pressures of the Depression and the vandalism and violence that broke out one Halloween evening, They decided, a lot of local organizations started to try to create a more controlled celebration, and that's where we started to see a lot of communities start their Halloween celebrations. And then once the sugar rationing after the war ended, that's when trick-or-treat became treats, more treats than anything else. And so regardless of the history or the reasons behind it, everyone go out, enjoy Halloween, dress up, have fun, be safe. Thank you.
And now you know the rest of the story.
Yeah.
You say trick or treat.
All right, we'll move along to item 11, approval of claims. A is a resolution approving claims. One is a presentation of claims over $25,000. City manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. We have $37,502.15 to Freeborn County Highway Department. This is for Highway 13 Joint City County Multi-Use Trail. We have $37,905 to Apex Facility Solutions, LLC. Payment estimate number 4 for design of ice arena and aquatic center project. $62,494.97 to Freeborn Mauer Electric Cooperative. This is electrical services at the wastewater treatment plant. $120,023 to Apex Facility Solutions, LLC. This is payment estimate number 5 for the refrigeration floor design and amendment general conditions for the arena project. $318,981.78 to Landscape Structures, LLC. This is the inclusive playground equipment purchase.
Council.
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second, Your
Honor. Second by Councilor Anderson. Any questions? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Item 12 is we will be entering into closed session subject to Minnesota Statute 13D.05, Subdivision 3C, to discuss the sale of city-owned property. Is there a motion to go into...
Move to go into
motion by Councilor Anderson. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Before we vote, the statute requires that we identify the specific property that's going to be discussed at the closed session.
Okay.
Your Honor, I can read the report.
City manager?
We'll be going to closed session to discuss the potential, to discuss the offers and potential sale of real property located at 821 Jefferson Avenue or ID number 34-0140470. Council will give instruction to the city manager on how to proceed with the offers upon reopening the meeting.
Thank you.
All right. All in favor of the motion going into closed session, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. We are in closed session.